Welcome to Conversations with Zaki Baruti with your host, Zaki Baruti. And like I always want to give a shout out to my biological family, what's going on, to the Universal African People's Organization family, what's happening, and to the New Life Evangelistic family. Keep up the great work led by Reverend Rice. On that note, we're going to have another great show. In studio with me is the lovely, vivacious, and very intelligent reporter. From television reporter from NBC station 17 out of central Illinois, specifically Decatur.
Yeah.
Right, man, that's none other than Ashante Ford.
Thank you for having me, Zachary.
Okay, well, once again, welcome.
Yeah, you know,
this had you on earlier, and it's always a pleasure to have such intelligence and beauty.
Thank you
for the show. On that note, before I always like to share with our listening audience, you know, some information about the guest.
Sure.
So I'd like for you to share that. But before you do that, I'd like to just give a quick announcement for our organization, Universal African People's Organization. We are inviting all of those of you who are listening in the St. Louis area and beyond that we're going to be celebrating our 30th anniversary with a fundraiser, Wine and Cheese fundraiser. And that's going to be on the founding date of our organization, April the 4th. And that's going to take place at the Jewel Event Center. And it's a donation, kind donation, that also can be used for what we'll call membership fee as we go and gather 144,000 members supportive of the organization. Mark that on your calendar. April the 4th, Jewel Center. Anybody interested, they can get in contact with us at area code 314-833-4151, or you can call me directly, 314-477-4629. On that note, flipping the script, going back to Ashante Ford, share with our audience Ashante Ford, where you grew up. I mean,
a little back.
We want to know about you.
Yeah, I am originally from California, born and raised in Fresno. Moved to the Bay Area, I would say maybe in my late teens. Loved it. Stayed in San Francisco for about 10 years. Graduated from San Francisco State. We were just talking earlier, went to Miami and then went to LA and then went to Maryland and kind of bounced all around. And then just recently accepted my first anchoring job after years of interning and reporting.
Well, congratulations.
Yeah, thank
okay
you.
Then.
Thank
so
you,
how long
you.
Have you been on your
current job? We are coming up on 6 months here pretty soon.
And that's your first job as an anchor person?
As an anchor, yeah. I reported and I filled in and I did feature and breaking news and all that before, but this is my first one where I have a show that I anchor, yeah.
So how has that experience been?
It's been awesome. You know, it's also been humbling with more responsibility in the newsroom, just like other things, you know, comes more responsibility.
Real quick, because we're going to be talking about another subject outside of what you do. But for those who's listening and, you know, you serve as a role model for other young sisters growing up who may want to become a reporter, what would be your words of wisdom in terms of seeking that kind of profession?
Consistency.
Consistency.
I did internships in newsrooms in college. I had to do unpaid. I had to do more unpaid internships after college. And I always showed it willing. I applied for hundreds of jobs before I got my first bite. But once I was in, I was in. So I would say consistency.
So consistency. Everybody hear that? Consistency.
Consistency.
If you want to be in the field of communication and especially in the role of as a reporter.
Absolutely.
And I know you project real great there. On that note, off the air from our last time you visited us here in studio, we were talking about a issue that impacts our community and not just our community, but throughout America. And that's the whole question of the mental health of people.
Yes.
And I want to kind of delve a little bit into that, even though I know you're not a mental health specialist.
Yes,
but,
not at all. Don't claim to be.
Right. But on a personal note, I know we've had, like I said, off the air discussions about that particular issue and the stigma that surrounds mental illness in communities. But before we get into that, I just want to cite a couple of statistics.
Okay.
In terms of the state of mental health throughout America. In fact, over 44 million American adults have a mental health condition. Now, that's 44 million out of approximately 300 million. Mm-hmm. And the rate of youth experiencing a mental health condition has continually risen in the last few years. And in fact, with major depressive episodes, and that has increased from when they first did a study, and this comes from the mental health findings, the state of mental health, from 11% over to close to 13%. And but also on the positive side, more Americans are insured and accessing care. Although many Americans experiencing a mental health condition still report having unmet needs. In fact, one in five have felt that they have not been, their needs for help have not been experienced. Mm-hmm. And then mental health workforce, there's a shortage in many states. So why is that of real importance to you in terms of that whole issue?
Yeah, there's so much to say there. I mean, growing up in a Black community and not so much making it out of that community, but growing up in a world where there are different races and you get to see different cultures, I find that in my experience, it's the African-American community predominantly that doesn't want to talk about mental health issues. They don't want to talk or acknowledge what depression is or bipolar disorder or personality disorder. They don't want to, in my experience, acknowledge that those things mean something. You know, it's kind of like the mom back in the day, you have a child that may be suffering from depression and she just says, you know, go drink some water, you know, or go take a nap. And even in the stories that I do and have done over the years with people that have committed suicide and their families that are left over to grieve, the effect that not talking about mental disorders has on the Black community, I find to be greater in other races.
So why do you think that is the situation? But before we get into why you feel that way, we'll have to take a quick break and we'll come right back.
Okay.
I want to thank God for each and every one of you that are supporting NLEC TV, the work of the New Life Evangelistic Center, and making it all possible so we can have conversations with Zaki on the air along with the other programming that's on NLEC TV. Not only we discover that at 24.2, but I actually watch it on my cell phone at a very special app that we have of NLEC TV, and you can just pull it up. It's so easy that everybody can watch it anywhere. So wherever I travel, I can be watching this program and other programs. Now, all this is possible only because of caring people like you that are sharing those much-needed tax-deductible gifts at this time with the New Life Evangelistic Center. We have a lot of things that are unfolding at this moment. We're continuing to help multitudes of people, not only throughout Mid-America, but as far away as India and Africa and other locations around the world. And we really do need your help. After they closed down 1411 Locust, we're continuing to help the homeless directly out on the streets every week. We're out in the mayor's window distributing bus tickets and other direct supplies. We have regular events out in front of 1411 Locust. And we're working actually through the legal, the mediation, the advocacy, and getting prayer warriors to pray that we can reopen 1411 Locust in the near future. But we need your involvement at this particular moment. And your gifts to the New Life Evangelistic Center make such a big difference. You can send that to P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, that's 63166, or you can give online through the PayPal system at newlifeevangelisticcenter.org or NLECSTL. I ask you to continue to stand with us right now as we continue to bring many programs like Conversation with Zaki to you, but we need your help.
How important are St. Louis Metro passes to the needy? To provide stability and permanent change to the homeless, they need jobs. But how do they get transportation to look for work when they have no money? And when they find a job, how will they get there? Become a part of NLEC's MetroPass program and help bring enduring change to a life.
I have doctor's appointments that I have to attend, going to seek jobs and putting in applications. I really would like you to understand the importance and the need for this ministry. And anything that you can do to keep this ministry going, please know that it is an extension of God's love.
Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus.
Welcome back to Conversations with Zaki Baruti. In studio with me is Ms. Ashante Ford, a reporter for Channel 17 in Decatur, Illinois. And we're looking at a subject that's not discussed widely, and that's mental illness, and not in the general sense, as well as in particular in the Black community. And it is Ms. Ford's contention that that's not really discussed openly too many times. It's kind of like a hidden topic. Is that okay then?
Yeah, I think so.
So, in your short experience of life,
very short,
you say that in terms of your experiences, you find that that whole topic has not been discussed too much.
Yeah, I think in my own personal experience, I grew up with someone that had bipolar disorder. And I didn't find that out until many years later. You know, I grew up with this person, and I didn't know until I was maybe 26 that she had bipolar disorder. And it was kind of mentioned as a footnote type of situation. You know, we were just talking. It was like, oh, you know, by the way, I have bipolar disorder. And even then, we didn't unpack it. And so later on in life, you know, I guess as you grow up, you try to reach back. I think the hymn is Sankofa. You have to reach back to be able to move forward. And so as I reach back and I look at some of those things that I went through when I was younger that there was no explanation for, it was because this person was bipolar. And I just wonder, you know, the effect, the positive effect it would have had on me as a child if we had that conversation, you know, as a child, like, you know, this is why this person, you know, behaves this way. This isn't necessarily the right way to behave, but this is why, you know. I just think that would have had a very positive effect on me as a child and into my adult years.
So in discussion of that, are you willing to share who was that member?
Not yet. I'm working on a book. So closer to when that book is coming out, you know, you and I will have that first talk.
Oh, okay then. And in terms of the impact of that disorder on you.
Yes.
Can you share some of that?
Yeah. Well, you know, as a child, I think your number one yearning is to be loved and to feel safe. And when you grow up with a guardian, I guess you can say, that is bipolar, it changes your skew of what you find appropriate. And now your needs that you naturally have as a child, when you don't get those things, you begin to internalize as if, you know, I'm not getting these things because of me, not because this person has a mental illness. And so I absolutely think that having that conversation in my household would have bridged the gap for me as a kid. It would have given me a level of understanding for what's normal. And what's not normal, but what's okay, mm-hmm. as opposed to this is just what it is, this is reality.
Mm-hmm. Now, for those who may not understand what is bipolarism,
sure.
Explain from your study, have you done...
I have done a lot of studies on it, but I will just say in plain, bipolar disorder means you could be out on a sunny day with someone and you stop to get ice cream and you get back in the car and you're driving somewhere, and in that split moment, your entire day changes. This person is now livid, and somehow, because it's not explained why, as a child, you take it on and you feel like it's because of you. So the simplest way that I can explain bipolar disorder is you are one way one time, and then an exact extreme the next.
The next. So that comes, a term comes to my mind, split personality. Would that kind of
be? In a large way. And the thing with bipolar disorder, just like depression and a lot of other things, if it's a healthy conversation around it and you're getting some help with it, you might be on meds. So you might not have those kind of episodes. But if you're in denial of it, and you don't see a doctor, or you see a doctor and you don't take your meds, you know, that's when it becomes another situation.
So it's your contention that many people are in denial that that exists within the family structure.
Yeah, I think bipolar disorder, absolutely. I think another big one is depression. I think, you know, all races have an issue with accepting depression as a clinical mental illness.
You know, in fact, in studying statistics around depression, especially in the Black community, as I had given earlier, 44 million people or Americans are impacted by mental health conditions. But specifically for the Black community, it's right at 6.8 million that are diagnostically have mental conditions, with one of the major issues dealing with depression. And also out of that, of course, as you mentioned earlier, suicide. So in terms of tackling that issue, have you personally organized any kinds of movement toward addressing that issue?
No, but I will say, you know, as I'm just coming into myself and learning who I am as a person and a woman, it's that, you know, that reaching back again. So I have, you know, read a lot of books and ordering more books and just kind of reading up on my experience as a child. So I don't know if I'm quite ready to lead yet. But I do have my nose in the books of the study, and it does help. It does help.
Now, outside of your own personal experiences, what about friends and what have you? Have you seen, can you speak on that? But before you speak on it, we got to take another quick break.
It's the gifts of caring people like you that help keep the Zaki Baruti Show on the air, dealing with hard issues, issues that we must begin to recognize in our community, issues that are frequently ignored by much of the existing media. And St. Louis and the St. Louis area is a community that's famous for its Jim Crow policies of keeping the people down by elevating the rich and the powerful. I want to encourage you to get a copy of the book, Through the Fire, as you share your gift of $10 or more to help keep Zaki's program on the air and directly help the hurting and the homeless. This book goes into great detail of how the bigotry and the self-centeredness of the rich and powerful was implemented through the politicians to drive the homeless out of the area by shutting down the Work a New Life Evangelistic Center. But the work isn't shut down. It's moving forth in many other different locations. It's moved out on the streets among the people, and it's working to get back into 1411 Locust, all of which is made possible through the prayers and gifts of caring individuals like you. And that's why your gift is so very important at this time. And as you share that gift with New Life Evangelistic Center of $10 or more at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166, be sure you request your copy of Through the Fire. Yes, God is moving in a mighty way. New Life Evangelistic Center has not given up in spite of all the persecution, has given it to God, and we're seeing Him now do exceedingly abundantly beyond what we can even ask or think. I ask you to continue to pray for us at the New Life Evangelistic Center as we're working to continue to bring you community programming like the Zaki Baruti Show and are out on the streets among the homeless, working among the homeless, distributing bus tickets every week and emergency supplies for them, opening up safe houses for the homeless, women and children, expanding training programs for the homeless. All of it is possible because of each one of you that is sharing that much-needed gift now with New Life Evangelistic Center. So when you send your gift of $10 or more, please request a copy of Through the Fire. It's P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri. That's 63166.
Hear this, you who trample the needy and do away with the poor of the land. Let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. You trample on the poor and force him to give you grain. Therefore, though you have built stone mansions, you will not live in them. Though you have planted lush vineyards, you will not drink their wine. For I know how many are your offenses and how great your sins. You oppress the righteous and take bribes, and you deprive the poor of justice in the courts.
Welcome back to Conversations with Zaki Baruti. In studio with me is Ashanti Ford, a reporter from Decatur, Illinois, anchor woman. And we're just talking about a subject that is very dear to her heart, and that is the mental conditions of people throughout America, and particularly the black community. On the other side, I was asking you in terms of, one, are you on point of translating your concern to an organized movement to address that issue, as well as have you in your short stay of life been impacted by other friends that and associates that you know of?
Well, I don't actually have any friends that I could think of that have expressed to me that they have any mental disorders, but I think we live in a day where even if they did, they probably wouldn't really discuss that. Mm-hmm. Our society can be kind of cruel with that, but I guess to answer your first question, I do think, especially in the African American community, we need to find a way that we can feel more comfortable and open with discussing mental health issues.
And you know what? One of the effects of mental illness and is the whole issue of homelessness. I think mm-hmm. there's a number of people who have been impacted by mental conditions that lead into homelessness. And also, one of the statistics points out the fact that many people in our community experience post-traumatic stress disorder, which, you know, you talk about PST for many people who go to war coming back, you know, they are all stressed out and having all kinds of issues. But then when you look at the kind of violence many times that occur in our communities, and young people see oftentimes crime scenes and are victims of crimes, but there's no health providers that come in to deal with that. Do you want to just address that from your perspective?
Well, I mean, as a reporter, you know, we see a lot of dead bodies, and we console a lot of crime mothers. And, you know, unfortunately, a part of a reporter's job is being in that community that they serve, and sometimes it can get ugly. But I don't know for other stations, I can't speak for all of them, but I know we're not provided with any mental health assistance, after that. We have our directors that we could speak to, but again, we would have to actually seek that out. Now, because I'm in a point in my life where I'm really like hungry and thirsty for that knowledge, I do seek that out. But I mean, you raise a good point, you know, where is the mental health assistance for people that have to continually see those kind of images?
Yeah, and that's a great point. I hadn't even looked at in terms of just the reporters that many times mm-hmm. just have to go to the various scenes and then on many of the scenes you see the wailing mothers or the sons.
It's hard to not take it home sometimes.
Right, yeah. right. So how do you cope personally?
Wine.
One of my favorite beverages, wine. Okay.
No, but the way that I cope with dealing, or the way that I cope with covering stories like that, is I stay very close to some of these mothers. There are some mothers and aunties and dads that, you know, still have my cell phone number, and we keep in touch, and we like each other's pictures on Facebook. So I guess my way of coping with pain like that is to stay connected to the person through their grieving and their growth.
Well, you know what? That also, as we discussed, just brings up to my mind the priority of government as relates to providing dollars for, you know, such an issue of mental wellness in our community. Mm-hmm. I can recall during the Reagan era, I have to say that, there was massive cuts of dollars for mental health issues. So address that from your perspective. Yeah.
With the cut for the mental health, you know, I was working in Kansas as a reporter at the time, and I was working with this family whom was so frustrated because they were trying to get their family member checked into a mental facility. Now, it's more than that, though, right? Because more times than not, that person doesn't want to go. So they finally got this person in a space where they're ready to go, and there's just no beds. And I don't know why. I don't know why. I can't really speak for why, because you would think that that would be a top priority. But I have covered stories, and I have dealt closely with family members who were devastated, just not because they didn't want the help, which is hard enough to ask for, but just the resources weren't there for them.
Right. On that note, we're going to take one last break and be right back.
An epidemic of homelessness is sweeping throughout the United States of America. In city after city, people are ending up on the streets. Now, instead of feeling overwhelmed, as believers, we can do three things. We can give, we can volunteer, and we can pray. We can pray for the homeless refugees that we're finding in one city after another, all over the United States. So many people ending up out on the streets. And the hearts of so many are growing cold at this particular time and indifferent to the need. Jesus said, as oft as you've done it to the least of these, he said, even so you've done it unto me. When's the last time you've prayed for the homeless refugees in the United States of America, appearing in city after city, not only in major cities, but even smaller cities? So many people ending up out on the streets, even in resort areas, places you never think you'd find homeless people, they're there. Jesus said, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head. Please pray for the refugees. Please pray for the homeless people in America. And pray for those that are on the front lines, the first responders, reaching out through Jesus Christ among the homeless and hurting, whether it's in Springfield or St. Louis. Your prayers and gifts to the New Life Evangelistic Center makes a big difference. This New Life Evangelistic Center, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166.
2 Timothy 1, verse 10.
But it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel.
Welcome back to Conversations with Zaki Baruti, and we only have a couple minutes left with Ms. Ashante Ford. In summing up from your perspective, the whole issue, and the time is just so short, we need to be able to really delve even further into it. And I appreciate you wanting to speak to this because, you know, this is a subject that we definitely need to be dealing with in our community. What would be some of the recommendations that you think needs to go forward to address the issue of mental illnesses in our community or in general?
Yeah, I think for me, it's addressing the issue with being open about discussing mental health issues in our community. And I think what we need to do is continue doing things like you and I are doing now. We just need to talk about it. We need to get more familiar with them. We need to educate ourselves with them so that we can identify those things in other people and then make a decision for what that means now for us. I think open conversations and reading. I don't read enough. I used to read a lot. I don't read enough. So, you know, I'm victim to this too, but I would say.
Is that one particular book that you would recommend?
Body Talks. The Body Talks. And The Body Talks, I wish I could think of the author. But
that's the title.
Yes. And it basically is a book that talks about how your body releases trauma that you've been through. Because what the thesis of the book says is that all trauma is released in one way or another. There's a good way that you could release it, and then there's a bad. So Body Talks, I would say I would recommend that book.
But, you know, as I was coming into the studio, I was reflecting when we talk about mental illness, the very first on a biblical level, I guess the very first mental illness was when Cain slew his brother Abel.
Mm-hmm.
Did I have the biblical characters right?
You do.
And then when I look at the statistics about murder in America, that each year over 40 some thousand people, I believe is the statistic, maybe even higher, are murdered in America. So that's also an extension of probably mental illness all of America.
Yeah,
so on that note, though, it's very short to the point. I appreciate you again.
Thank you for having me.
And once you get that book together, we'll have to have you in the studio dealing with that.
I will call you first.
All right. So on that note, I just want to again thank you for
being
in the studio with me, and to our listening audience. Get involved. Join an organization that's about the business. Look at the UAPO. You go on our website, www.uapo.org. On that note, may God bless each and every one of you.